Hello friends, welcome to Engineering Today, and we're back with the exciting news of SpaceX Transporter 1 launch. And now it's official. SpaceX just officially broke the record for most satellites launched on a single rocket by deploying a total of 143 satellites into orbit. January 24th, on a fine Sunday morning, SpaceX conducted the record-breaking Transporter 1 launch that nailed the first stage booster landing. At about 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, SpaceX's two-stage Falcon 9 rocket lifted off from the Space Launch Complex 40 at Cape Canaveral Space Force Station here in Florida. In this mission, SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket carried 143 satellites, which is now the biggest carpool to space. Falcon 9 will fly south along the eastern coast of Florida on its way to space, SpaceX officials tweeted. The live broadcast for this launch kicked off around 12 minutes before the liftoff. At the beginning, SpaceX's production supervisor Andy Tran was given the mission introduction. As the time went, SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket completed its engine chilling process, which is required to avoid any thermal shocks in the system. According to the information, the visitor complex opened at 9 a.m. to allow a limited number of guests to launch viewing. Up until now, the record for most launch satellites on a single rocket was set by Indian PSLV rocket that launched in 2017. The rocket carried a total of 104 satellites under its Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle PSLV C-37 program. Now SpaceX officials broke that record by launching 143 satellites into orbit. The Transporter 1 launch was originally scheduled to lift off on Saturday morning, but later delayed due to poor weather conditions at the launch site. Due to unfavorable weather, we are standing down from today's launch. The team will continue with the countdown until T-minus 30 seconds for data collection. Another launch attempt is available tomorrow, January 24, with a 22-minute window opening at 10 a.m. EST, SpaceX tweeted on Saturday. Again, Transporter 1's previous delays are actually quite understandable because SpaceX has to look out for the needs for multiple customers. Here, every customer's satellites are different and have unique requirements, which makes it even more challenging. But overcoming every challenge on its path, SpaceX successfully deployed a mix of CubeSats, space tugs, and other microsatellites to a 326-mile high polar orbit. Sunday's weather was also quite challenging for this mission, although the launch went off without any issue. SpaceX's Starlink constellation continues to grow outside of Earth, with each Starlink launch scheduled for each month. Not long ago, on January 21st, SpaceX launched its next batch of 60 Starlink satellites to orbit. In this mission, SpaceX also has 10 of its own Starlink satellites inside Falcon 9's payload fairing. Deploying Starlink satellites on a unique polar orbit will actually provide low-latency, high-speed internet service to customers in Alaska and other polar regions. The Starlink satellites on board will be the first in the constellation to deploy to a polar orbit, SpaceX tweeted. Not only SpaceX created a world record by launching 143 satellites to orbit, but also the company successfully recovered the first-stage booster of Falcon 9. Falcon 9 first-stage booster's Merlin engine ignited to perform a series of entry burn to slow down the booster while entering Earth's atmosphere. Around 10 minutes after the launch, Falcon 9's first-stage booster successfully landed at SpaceX's Of Course I Still Love You drone ship, which marked the 73rd booster recovery in overall orbital class rocket. Falcon 9's first stage has landed on the Of Course I Still Love You drone ship, SpaceX confirmed on Twitter. According to records, it was the fifth flight for this veteran booster, also known as B-1058. The booster first started its journey with SpaceX's Demo 2 mission in May 2020. The Transporter 1 mission also marked SpaceX's third launch of 2021. The deployment process began about 58 minutes after the liftoff, with a SpaceX call, "Deployment sequence has begun," and ended with the deployment of SpaceX's own Starlink satellite. After the deployment of 133 satellites, SpaceX confirmed on Twitter, "Rideshare customers deployment confirmed," leaving 10 Starlink satellites. Falcon 9 was carrying 133 other satellites in its rideshare mission. along with the other satellites aboard on SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket, include 30 small satellites for the US and Europe, which was packaged by Berlin, also 48 Earth imaging satellites, known as Super Dove, 17 small communication satellites for Toronto-based Kepler, 9 satellites by NanoRacks, and more. NanoRacks said in a tweet, "NanoRacks is excited to have 9 of the 143 spacecrafts on this historic mission." Hitching a ride on SpaceX's Transporter 1 mission this morning is PTD-1, the sole CubeSat of our Elena 35 mission. Officials of NASA's Launch Service Program tweeted just a few minutes before the live broadcast began. Sunday's mission was the first step for SpaceX's rideshare program, where the main goal is to provide small satellite operators a ride to space in SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket with competitive pricing. In 2019, SpaceX unveiled its rideshare program, which offers a cheap access to space for small satellite services, starting from $1 million for the first 485 pounds. Offering provides increased access to space for small satellite operators seeking a reliable, affordable ride to orbit, SpaceX officials tweeted. Our second news is based on Northrop Grumman and L3 Harris. On the 22nd of January 2021, the Missile Defense Agency granted Northrop Grumman with a contract worth $155 million. The Defense Department's Missile Defense Agency has chosen both Northrop Grumman and L3 Harris to develop a prototype sensor satellite by each of them. This sensor satellite will be capable of easily tracking any intercontinental ballistic and hypersonic missiles. 4 companies were on the row with the designs of sensors. Those companies were Raytheon, Leidos, Northrop Grumman, and L3 Harris. Out of them, only designs of last 2 companies were selected. On the 14th of January, L3 Harris got a $121 million contract, on the other hand. The Larger Missile Warning Network of the Space Development Agency, Pentagon, will be comprised of the Hypersonic and Ballistic Tracking Space Sensor satellites and will also incorporate Wide Field of View missile tracking satellites. These satellites will be positioned in the low Earth orbit to examine the capabilities of the sensors in tracking hypersonic and low upper stage ballistic missiles. These medium field of view sensors have the ability of generating fire control data and warning which is of utmost need in order to target an interceptor weapon to destroy the enemy missile in air. The hypersonic and ballistic tracking space sensor and the tracking layer programs are based on the overhead persistent infrared technology of US Space Force, which makes sense in low and high orbits to provide premature issuance of warning for any missile launches. This technology also helps in finding out the location of an incoming missile and conveys the location information to an interceptor missile, which will attempt to destroy it. 15 months before, the Missile Defense Agency awarded Northrop Grumman, Raytheon, Leidos, and L3 Harris each $20 million contracts for designing space sensors of the Hypersonic and Ballistic Tracking Space Sensor Program. The 2 winners, Northrop Grumman and L3 Harris, have to deliver prototype satellites by the middle of 2023. It's expected that the Missile Defense Agency and the Space Development Agency both will buy hundreds of satellites to ensure global coverage and protect Earth from threat of war. Our last news for today is based on French startup ThrustMe. ThrustMe, a French startup space company, has sent the first iodine electric propulsion system, NPT-30-I2-1U, into space. The iodine propulsion system was launched aboard the Baihengkongshi 1, a 12U CubeSat developed by Chinese company Spacety. This way, ThrustMe has completed the first on-orbit tests of the iodine-fueled electric propulsion system. The test has confirmed the ability of the system to reorient a CubeSat's orbit. Dmytro Rafalski, CTO of ThrustMe, said, "It's been a long road to bring this product from dream to reality. To make it happen, we had to innovate, develop a complex system from the ground up, and perform fundamental research studies since many properties of iodine are missing in scientific databases. In November last year, a Chinese Long March 6 rocket has sent the satellite into orbit. Weeks later, after launch, at the end of December, the propulsion system was tested for the first time, and for the second time early in January. The duration of the burns was 90 minutes each. Thrustme said on a press briefing that the burns resulted in change of altitude by 700 meters, and that proved iodine to be a feasible propellant to electric propulsion systems, according to Thrustme. According to a report, Anna Einesland, CEO of Thrustme, has said that, on top of that, we're preparing for two in-orbit demonstrations of our 1.5U version that has a predicted total impulse capacity of 9,500 newtons. The first one coming up in 2021 is a National Space Agency mission that we will announce later. Thrustme declares that the use of iodine as a propellant will bring a revolution in the satellite industry. This electric propulsion system will help small satellites to reduce its altitude and becoming obsolete. This will reduce its time in orbit. On re-entry into Earth's atmosphere, the satellite will burn up, and this way it will help reducing space debris in lower Earth orbit. Normally, fuels used for electric propulsion systems are xenon or krypton, which are rare and expensive, and also needs high-pressure storage. But in the case of iodine, when it's heated, the solid iodine directly turns to gas without passing through the liquid stage. A further demonstration is planned to be done aboard the GOM space, GOM-X5 mission, scheduled to launch in mid-2022. NPT-30-I2-IU is also being prepared for the geostationary satellite market. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.